so beyond excited to be here. First of all, I just talked to some of my friends and my people that are here, and they know better than to go Facebook Live, because sometimes, I swear. So I'm trying to be on good behavior, but I'm working on my speech. I was like, careful what you say, but I kind of get a little bit wrapped up when that happens. And another thing that people from GG's know that I do when I say woo-hoo a lot. I get excited and I say woo-hoo. And when I do that at our galas or at our national conference, that means you have to take a shot or a drink. So you guys can save them all up for tonight. Woo! All right. I honestly have like sores in my mouth because you guys are the people that are gonna change the world for my daughter. All of us are in this together. We're bound by a diagnosis that our kids wear on their faces. So each one of our successes are successes for everybody. And I just want you guys to know, being here today and hoping to be able to touch you in any way possible, if I can just touch you in one way, that makes everything all worth it. I'm just beyond floored by everything that you guys are doing and what you're doing to unite as a group. So cheers to you guys. I hope you guys have given yourselves applause many times this weekend because you definitely deserve it. I'm going to skim through. You're going to see, I know you know about open heart surgeries and the diagnosis. I'm not really going to go through that part of my journey with GiGi, but that was all there, but I don't think you guys need to hear that. We've all kind of been through all that piece. I think what you probably don't know about me is that two of my biggest fears are flying and public speaking. And guess what I have to do every day because of GiGi now? She truly challenges me and makes me face my fears every day. It doesn't mean I'm good at it. So now that I'm here, you're gonna see I might go off on a tangent, and if I do, somebody yells squirrel, and I'll go to just turn it around, and I'll get off of that in a minute. But you are here today to be the best mom that you can be to your child. And that's exactly why I'm here today, too. And my first child was born in 1996, my son, Franco. And I remember he was crying one night. I just wanted a little break away from him. He was crying. My husband brought him in and couldn't get him to calm down. And he placed him in my arms, and I just remember I kind of took him, and I placed my hand on his cheek, and I almost felt like the calm in his body. And he stopped crying and kind of stood with me. And I just remember staring at my hand, and like, why do I have this power? And what did I do to deserve this? As a mom, how did I just get this? Why do we have it? And it just felt like this tremendous responsibility. I realized that awe of a mother's hand is something, it's a gift that we are all given. I realized I was responsible now for instilling in him confidence, generosity, grace, independence. I was in control of this tiny little life. And I don't know why I was given that gift. All of us are given that gift. I cannot help but think about each and every one of you and the power you have been given to raise your beautiful child. All of your children, not just your child with Down syndrome. I tell people all the time that parents of kids with Down syndrome are the strongest parents that I know, even if they don't know it. I know we don't always feel like we're that strong, but we are. I know you have been given that power and that strength, even on the days you don't think you have it. Ask for help if you need it. For some people, that's hard. Believe me, I get it. I'm one of those people. Protect that power. And protect your strength from negativity. There's a lot of negativity in the world out there. And I think this group I know is really involved in social media. Stay away from that negativity. Stay away from people who choose to be negative. There's a bunch of categories. I kind of think back just at just the last 15 years with GiGi, and I think about all the different categories of the moms I've met. There's the, I got this mom, like, I'm gonna own this. That's the DSDN Rockin Mom. You know, knowing, always gonna be positive, trying their hardest, and educating themselves. How am I gonna do this? I don't know how I'm gonna do it, but I'm gonna do it. Then there's the feel sorry for me mom. I cannot see the good in anything. Then the my child is perfect mom, which is just annoying. There's always those. The full of excuses, no expectations, moms. Those are the ones you want to slap in the face. I mean, self-fulfilled prophecy You know, if you say to something and you will it to happen, you know, you want to will great things to you. When you say every day, I can't, you're willing that to happen to your child, or he can't do that. You're making that happen. Don't let that happen. Don't be that person. Think about that one. The complainer mom, never going to be happy, you know that one. And the dinosaur mom, that's kind of stuck in that old way of thinking and isn't willing or doesn't want to move forward and look where we really can go with Down syndrome. All of us, I think, fall in, you know, we were one of those moms. And I think we dip into those other ones. We have our days when we dip into those other ones, and that's when you really got to dig deep and find that strength and pull yourself up. And remember that power of your hand. Remember the strength and the power that you were given when you became a mother. Surround yourself with those positives. If you take on other people's negatives, it will be hard to find your own positives. Be honest with your struggles, but be grateful. Protect yourself. Always be around people that will make you better. If you see yourself in some of the other categories that I just talked about, try to change it. Just small changes every day. Just one little bit of gratitude a day can really help change a whole mindset. Whether you know it or not, each one of you have the strength and power to change the world. You really do. I never thought that I could. I was flying by the seat of my pants, relying on God, miracles, and a thrown together business plan that was literally on a napkin from a bar. Literally. A miracle is not always pretty or easily seen, and sometimes you have to search for them. It may even be disguised in pain or tragedy. It is what you do with that pain that brings your miracle to the forefront. It is finding that inner strength to propel yourself to action. And do not think you don't have it. You are born with it, just like the hand. Sometimes you just have to find it. Sometimes you just have to dig for it. And that brings me back to the hand. Yes, I could count him, but I was also a total freak of a mom, a first-time mom. I literally peeled his grapes and his hot dogs for 4 years. Like, it wasn't just 4 years, and then I still cut him in half. It was really bad. And at the time, what I was trying to have another child, and we were struggling with a lot of fertility issues. So, any of you moms out there who have had that, I'm with you, girls. That never seeing that little pink, all you wanted was that little pink line so badly. The nurse on the other end after IVF, hi hon, sorry. Constantly over and over again. We struggled with fertility for about 3 years, all those shots, devastation, and we were about to adopt. So I happened to meet this boy. This is how ignorant I was about Down syndrome. I happened to meet this boy at Woodfield, you know, at Stratford Square Mall, and it was a boy with Down syndrome who was there. He was like in second grade, his name was Joey. And he was on a field trip, and I'm like, and I just kept thinking that he needed me. Like, he was drawn to me. This boy, like, wherever me and Franco went in the mall, I'm like, oh, there's Joey's group again. Joey was my Santa. There we were. We went to leave the mall, and Joey's bus was right there, and Joey turned around and waved at me. And I literally went home, and again, I was on a lot of fertility drugs. I told Maddie, I had to go find this kid and adopt him because I'm a man now. And I called the school. This is even more embarrassing. More disclosure than most people don't know a lot of my stories because but I did. I called the school, I looked up the bus route that they're on, I called the school. I know. I looked at mom, like if somebody would have stopped my kid like that in the mall. So I knew I'm looking into adoption, but the Joey story is probably one I shouldn't share. That embarrassing now as a parent who like, oh my god, what made me think nobody would have wanted that boy. You know what I mean? What was I thinking? But that's where my head was. And we went then to adopt, still trying to adopt, but Joey was fine with his parents. And we ended up finding a mom that was half Italian, half Irish. I'm 100% Irish. And my husband's all Italian. I'm like, oh my gosh, this couldn't be more perfect. Well, as we were there, I remember we were meeting with her for breakfast. I was kind of having some problems with her. She had been on drugs and some other things that were going on. And I was getting sick when I was meeting with her. And I didn't know if it was anxiety or if it was, I didn't know what it was. But I knew, you know, my girlfriend's like, take a pregnancy test. And to me, this is where I was just about to swear. I just caught myself. I was like, F you, if you don't need those pregnancy tests I'm taking, it's not even fair to ask me to take that test. Like, I can't look at that. I can't have that again. I'm not even taking the test. Like, 2 weeks later, though, I still have something going on. And then my girlfriend's like, take the test. And I think that sounds French. So all the fertility, I quit everything, went to adopt, out of the blue, got pregnant. They said that his sperm and my egg were incompatible. And apparently they made up. Something happened that they are friendly again. And I had Bella. So that was amazing. We were finally that family of four. I wasn't the freak mom to Franco. Well, I still kind of was, but not as bad to Franco. And I had, both my husband and I had siblings that were sick. I have a brother who was schizophrenic and he was going through a really hard time, and Paul's sister was struggling with breast cancer. We were helping with her kids. So it was a busy time, but I was still full of gratitude because I had my children. I felt so blessed. And then one night we're out with my husband's biggest client, who really like afforded us a lot of luxuries, and he starts telling a joke, and he used the R word. And then he used the N word. And he's just using completely inappropriate stuff where I normally, with a client, that I would just walk away. This time, I ripped into that guy. Like, I saw my husband's face just go pure white, like, shut up. And like, I couldn't stop. I'm like, you know what? It's people like you. And I just, I could not stop. I was on this moral high horse. No idea why I did. I just told this mother off, like, you really, he had his girlfriend with him. So now we're driving to the restaurant afterwards, and my husband is like, what is wrong with you? Why? How could you do that? I go, you know what? I don't think that was appropriate. I don't think it was okay for him to talk like that in front of me. Like, what the? No. He was like, okay, yeah, okay, it was perfect. And we just went and met them at the restaurant. And again, there was, it wasn't a good night from that moment. I think I really burnt that bridge. We lost a little bit of money on that one. And the next week, I did the same thing with one of my family members. Again, I'm this moral high horse. Who do I think I am? And she, and it was literally like a stupid white lie that normally you'd let go. And this time I'm like, really? Really? You're going to do that? And just completely went off on her. And I don't know what finally made me take a pregnancy test. But I was pregnant. And I remember, I'm like, woo! Say that. Someone tell me. Tell me. I was like, oh my God. This baby has a voice. This baby is making me better today. Like, and I remember going, I'm like, holy crap, this is going to be like a world leader, the president. I was like, oh, okay. Like, he's just making his eyes. But I knew it. How do you make me change like that? How are you making me better when you're not even here? And the funny thing is, I forgot that all happened until Gigi was like 5 years old. I completely, it didn't even make sense. It looked, you know, she was, her voice was so loud from the time she was conceived. Before I even knew she was here. It just, when I think back on that and how it's all meant to be, it still blows me away because I don't know why I was given the incredible gift of being a mother and then of being Gigi's mother. Then came the birth, which I'm really not going to go. You guys know what that's all about. No eye contact. You know, they took good care of me medically, but to them, you know, my life was pretty much not ever going to be the same, and they kind of made me feel that way. And I did feel that way. I cried about it in the shower. I never did it in front of my kids. But it was there. There was a grief. There was like, now what am I going to do? I don't know how to be this mom. I didn't know how to be Franco's mom. And now I have to be this mom. I don't know how to raise somebody like this. I don't know. I didn't, you know, I felt like when you have a baby, a typical baby, they don't say, might get diabetes, could get ADD, might have cancer, could have, you know, maybe could have heart problems, maybe kidney problems, could have something with their trip. But with our kids, they tell us every negative thing. Anything that's happened to any kid with Down syndrome is on that laundry list that they give you. And it's just that heavy monkey on your back. And that was the part, like, I feel like I'm such a positive person, but that was the part that I wanted to help other people with, because I felt it wasn't fair. It's still not fair. That's not how we should be giving that diagnosis. And back then, things were a lot different. I mean, I know it was only 15 years ago, but like, there wasn't Facebook groups. There was some support groups, but they were really more support groups. They want play groups. They want, there weren't programs. There wasn't stuff like we have today. There was therapy that you went to the center and you did your therapy at. And I literally, like, I would see a kid with Down syndrome, like, at a mall. And I'm like, oh, hey, I got one! Negatives, everything that you're wearing on your back, that you could walk in there and just get away from that all and just see the potential in your child. Know you were going to be able to do this and that you were never going to be alone. That you would blaze that trail and we would help you every step of the way. I didn't know how I was going to do that, but that was kind of like, I was going to try to make that happen. I hadn't worked since Franco had been born. So, and when I did work, it was like right before like computers were really a big thing. So the only software package I knew how to use was, you know, I was a mom, I made a lot of cards, was American Greetings Creative Art Spiritual Expressions. And that's what every piece of GiGi's Playhouse literature was created in. There was, I had to do it by myself because that you couldn't even make a PDF. Now you just like, you know, there's a PDF maker, you just a PDF. I used to have to go to Kinko's to make it into a PDF so I could have people proof it because I sucked at grammar. I can't do all this stuff. But then you go to Kinko's and then you make it into a PDF and then everything would shift so you couldn't print it because it was all in different places. It was a complete nightmare. I literally would just sit there. I went and bought an HP printer and I literally breastfed Gigi and made like thousands of brochures to try and tell people what Gigi's Playhouse was going to be. My son Franco actually designed the logo, and then my husband told me everybody was going to sue us so that we can't do this. I'm like, so I called my insurance man, and I'm like, I want to start this place. And my insurance man wasn't there. He was on vacation, so some other guy answered the phone. I said, okay, well, I need to ask you a question. I kind of want to start this place. And of course, I want to prove my husband wrong, that insurance is not going to be an issue. And the guy was like, oh, okay, what kind of place? And I found that every time I used the word Down syndrome, like, it raised red flag. Like, oh my gosh, you're gonna need ramps. Like, it was crazy, every red flag that was raised. So I was like, I wanna start this this place for individuals with special needs, and it's a very positive where they're gonna come in and achieve their dreams and lots of potential and blah, blah, blah. And he was like, so like a school? I don't get what you're saying. Well, I don't know what I'm saying either. It's written on a napkin. You should be able to see for yourself. But. And he was like, I said, well, actually, it's for individuals with Down syndrome. And there was that pause. And then a second later, he goes, I have a son who's 16 with Down syndrome. Is there going to be something for him? And literally everything after that I did, the miracles just kept coming. And they keep coming to this day. And I've always said, when people ask me, like, when are you going to slow down? When is this going to slow down? I'm going to slow down when the miracles slow down. And they just have it. There's a higher power guiding this whole thing, and I'm just so blessed to be sitting in the driver's seat and to see there's 300 more drivers coming into the house. I love it. I'm so excited. I mean, this is how we create change. I mean, you guys are here because status quo is not okay for you. You are here because you want something better, and that's why I'm so excited to talk to you guys. So, anyways, we did end up opening the Playhouse. I knew that like my mom and dad would be there and a couple neighbors, and I had no idea who else was gonna show up. And we had almost 1,000 people at that first opening. And that's when I knew that this needs to be done. You know, the world was, I was so afraid they weren't ready for us, and they were just waiting for us. So since then, we now have 33 locations across the country, 100 of them, Clary's or more. Amazing things going on, and we probably don't know is when I built that first one, I didn't plan on running any of them, or that one. I didn't plan on having the first three of them. I didn't plan on running them. I knew that I had a gift of being able to raise money. I knew that I had a big mouth. I knew that I could get out there and get things done, but I gave it more as a gift to the Down syndrome community. Here, I will pay for this place. I will keep it running all the time. I'll put all the money, everything you guys need. Make your dreams come true. What are your dreams? You know, whatever your dreams are for your kids, let's make them happen. Like, we have a copier. Because like back then, you didn't have a copier. We didn't have a home record. Like, you didn't have all that stuff. So I'm like, the tools, like, everything is here. Like, what's the dream? What do you guys want? And I realized that the dream that they had were great, but they were very localized. It was a dream for one area. And only affecting one area was not going to change my daughter's life. It wasn't going to open people's eyes to their potential if I just changed it in one small part of the country. I wanted people to open their eyes to the potential of our kids. The only way we're going to create change is if we do this together and people see that we can make this change. So that's when I kind of had to step in and start running it, but we still did what we said and let parents dream come true. Our 5K started because a mom came in and said, I never thought I'd run a 5K with my daughter, and now I know I will. She started the 5K. Another mom started the literacy program. Our Mean and Grace program, our speech and language program, was started by another mom. So these are programs that people bring in. Our LMLP program, which is one of my favorites, was started by a mom in our Quad Cities location. So it's all of us together with our own ideas making this all happen. How much time do I have? So now how fast do you go? Okay. No, I'm kidding. All right, I'm almost done. Okay, I'm gonna figure out what I'm talking about because I'm going to talk. Okay, so I'm trying to pick the best stuff. Okay, I'm gonna do this one. So when I really started to understand Gigi's low muscle tone and the true strength that she really had, I felt it when I carried her to bed. I realized the weight that she carried around every day. You know, our kids feel when like they're asleep and they're just heavy. That's a lot to carry around. And when I felt that, I'm like, she doesn't complain to me. She does nothing but smile and want to do more for me. I need to be emotionally and physically better for her. I needed to build my strength. I joined a boot camp. I figured, you know what, if she can do the things she can do, I have regular muscles that work. And if I'm gonna take care of her properly, I need to take care of myself. You guys, that's a really big piece. We put ourselves last all the time. You gotta take care of yourself to be able to take care of her. And as they get older, they're gonna watch you. Like Gigi, I expect her to do 10 to 15,000 steps. She's like, where's your Fitbit? How many you? You know what I mean? Like, they know. We have to practice what we preach. That's a really important thing. With my kids, you know, you gotta teach your other children to never give up and make them understand what low muscle tone is and what it takes for our kids to do something. For Gigi to say, hi, my name is Gigi, it takes 44 different, hi, my name is Gigi, 44 different movements in her mouth from multiple muscles that don't work, that she has to teach. You know, typical kids, that just comes naturally. Our kids work so hard, make people understand how hard she has to work or he has to work. I think that's important. Make sure your kids understand it. People will have more patience, they will understand it more. Be hard on your kids. The harder you are on your kids, the stronger they're going to be. Always. Don't make it easy. Don't make it easy on them. Some of the cheats that I did, like, you know, when James was late, you know, that pincher grip, I used a pop tart. So, you know, when you're trying to get them to do, and my speech therapist was like, oh my God. She's 4 months old, she has all that sugar. I go, yeah, just wait till she's 14 years old. Like, who cares? It's making her pick her hand up and get it in her mouth. Like, do whatever it takes. You're gonna know your child best. You're gonna know what works for you. When Gene was like putting things down and didn't realize how heavy everything was, And she was always motivated by, you know, potato chips. I had her dip potato chips in dip. Like, that was her, I had baked blades, and then I had low-fat sour cream, and she'd go to dip it and just smash the shit out of that torch. Every time. And I'm like, well, gotta do it like this. You know, and it turned on, but she got it. So there's all these little, these are the little things that, I'm like, this, you guys can all teach each other. And it goes fast when you teach them that way. When I right before I came here today, GiGi's literacy, okay, I'm totally breaking GiGi's Playhouse rules, so who's ever in here, not talk about this at conference. GiGi's, right before I left the house, GiGi's literacy tutor dropped her off at home because they roll for Starbucks after literacy today. Totally against the rules. I know we're not supposed to leave them alone, but it's been her tutor for 2 years and they just roll for Starbucks. So they had to do it. And she came in saying, why is it? Can you help me? I had 2 or 3 other kids. How come GiGi writes so well? Why does she write so well? And I'm like, okay, first of all, like, I'm giving a speech in less than an hour, so you can't stay at my house. I gotta go. I gotta get over here. But what it is again, when you're harder on them, they're gonna be stronger. I didn't let her use, I used to tell her teacher, she's 3 years old. Why are you writing her name on her art project? That's not okay. She can write her own name. My other kids always wrote their own name on there. What is your expectation that she's not gonna write her own name? Like, I'd see their writing, and I'm like, again, see? I wanna throw it back in their face. You can't make things easy on our kids. The harder we are on them, the stronger they're gonna be. I used to make her write everything. I'd make her write Wikipedia. And she, when she loved that, Carly, go to Wikipedia, write it out. We got notebooks of stuff she had to write out. But you know, she does have beautiful writing. I didn't use a lot of assistive technology in school. They were like, well, she can do a report this way. I'm like, nope. Fine motor. The assistive technology is there and I love it. And she uses it for other things, but she also writes. She needs to be using those fine motor skills, and it's working for her. She's done amazing things. I'm gonna, right now she just started high school. And I think the most important thing is, you know, we all worry about our IEPs. Where are they gonna be going? What are they gonna be doing? And what I worried about the most when she started high school was, first of all, like my daughter Bella, my other daughter said, you need to throw away all her clothes from Justice. Like, don't make her look like that, Mom. She goes, you need to dress her like a freshman. I'm like, all right. So like, we hid from GiGi, we like threw all the Justice clothes away, got her the clothes. And we got her doing 10 to 15,000 steps a day. Started 2 weeks before school started. I was like, every day, get that on. You better be prepared because you're gonna be walking that school. And I didn't want to be fighting at school. I don't think it's fair. I don't think we can set them up to fail. If we know what's coming up, let's be prepared. She doesn't walk 15 steps. Like, she had 15,000 steps. She was like, what? I'm doing that. But when she started school that first day, she came home and she did 8,000 steps at school that day. And she came home and was like, oh my God, Mom, I did this, I did that. She's in 6 clubs now as a freshman. So she goes to yesterday and Thursday and Friday, went to clubs before school and after school. And she's able to keep her stamina. I mean, she's low tone like anybody else, but you know what? She's physically fit. And she's able to keep herself going. So just, there's so many great things I just want to be able to tell you guys, and I just always set your kids up for success. I know that that's why you're here, that you just want to learn more. If there's ever anything I can do, anything the Playhouses can do, I know we talked to my moms from every category, and I know they exist because unfortunately I see every category at the Playhouse. I've seen it all every day. I see kids succeeding, and then I also see the kids that are failing. And I know I'm failing, and it's really hard to not be able to step in and help change that. And sometimes it's just a lifestyle, and there's nothing I can do about it. But you know, just please always think about that low muscle tone. If your child, and you know, a diabetic needs insulin, our kids need fitness and therapy from day one and throughout. Don't ever stop doing that. I know it's harder as they get older. When they're little, it's easy. You put them on your lap, you read to them. Keep doing it. Don't ever stop. We'll let them be reading to you. Everything we do at the Playhouse is designed to help you succeed in this journey. If you need something, ask. We are here for you no matter where you live. We just redesigned all of our educational programs and they're just, I'm so beyond excited about that. GiGi started high school this year reading 118 words a minute. She's still in the literacy program to this day and she continues to learn every day. And I'm just so grateful to be on this journey with all of you guys, and that I only swore once, so thank you. And again, I just want you guys to know, if you ever doubt your strength, look for the miracles in any form. The miracles come in many different packages. don't always think they're going to be happy. Some of them are going to hurt you more than anything else in the world, but they will propel you to action and they will propel you to change. That's how some of the biggest obstacles, the biggest things we've done at GiGi have come because somebody hurt us and it really propelled us to action. So know that you've got that and know that you have this hand, that you were given this incredible strength because you deserve it, and just be responsible with it. Be the best mom that you can be. Lean on each other. Look what you guys have here. Lean on each other. There's so many people dealing with your diagnosis. I'm telling you, I there's still days I go back on Gigi's birthday and I'm like, I cry about how sad it was, like what it was all about back then. And I know so many of you guys are going through that. I know the moms that walk into the Playhouse still with the deer in the headlights look, because it is scary. I want you guys to know you're never going to be alone. Look at this group here, like, this is so awesome. January. Awesome. So I'm getting off. All right, I'm done. I only scored once. I'm good. I think I've got it.
And I don't know where that is compared to Hoffman Estates.
Yeah, it's close, but it wasn't supposed to be. Like-